Remind me, what was the requirement?
Sir, we said hydrogen atom problem. Someone, I think Shitikanda was saying scattering theory, and then WKB approximation, sir.
Okay. Maybe we can start.
Yes, sir. So we can start.
Okay, so let others join. So I am actually trying something today. That is, I thought I will do a problem which we started on the other day in StatMech class, but. It is actually a quantum mechanics problem, so I thought I will take this opportunity to show you that problem. What I will do is I have tried to record it myself before, and I will present the recorded version now, so that I think it will be like half an hour or something. I want to see how it works, so I am going to share. So this is not live, but I am going to present a recorded version. It is recorded, my voice has been recorded by me. So this is what, I want to know whether you are able to see the video and audio and those things. So what do you see now?
Landau levels.
Yeah, so you see that screen, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So,
in this lecture, we will discuss Landau levels.
Do you hear the voice?
So essentially,
yes, sir.
We are interested in trying to consider the effect of magnetic field on the. In this lecture, we will discuss Landau levels. So essentially, we are interested in trying to consider the effect of magnetic on the orbital motion. For that, we must solve the quantum mechanical problem of a charged particle moving in a unit. Let us consider a geometry like this. I have a slab. This has Ly.
Excuse me, sir.
Hello.
with, you know,
I.
Z. We are into the tato on E, so we substitute for the charge, electron charge. And since we have this magnetic field applied along Z direction, we can take a particular chemical, vector potential, which corresponds to something called an asymmetric gauge, which is also called a Landau gauge, is YB. Direction. So this is what we, this is a particular choice of gauge and Landau. So in the this particular gauge choice, the Hamiltonian can now be written as 1/2m. This is the Hamiltonian operator. So H bar by I is the momentum operator minus E Y B X cap. This is your A also. I can write this, can expand this and write it as 1/2m into minus R square, rho square by rho z square, minus h bar square, rho square by rho y square, plus I have this term h bar by I rho by rho x minus E Y B. Now this is the Hamiltonian. We want to find the eigenvalues, eigenfunctions, and eigenvalues of this this particular Hamiltonian. So our aim is to solve psi equal to. Now let's try to look at the Hamiltonian and then make some simplification of the wave function, or make it make an educated guess of what the wave function. You can see here that in this Hamiltonian only y coordinate is occurring, x coordinate and z coordinate are not occurring. So x and z coordinates are, we classically we call them as cyclic coordinates. Correspondingly, momentum along z and y are constants of it. And there is a translational invariance along z and x, z and x. Because y is occurring, there is no translational invariance along y. So this particular understanding will facilitate us to try for a solution like this. Okay, so try for a solution, because it is like a solution of the form. The Hamiltonian looks as if there's a free particle motion along z and function of x, y, z. So I can think distribution like. Power ikx the power ikz you get that substitute the so substitute in this organization I will write in class pi del y square. Okay, so wherever px px is there, we are going to put its eigenvalue. So plus 1 over 2m into h bar ax, where the eigenvalue corresponding to this dou by dou x operator, minus eyv whole square into pi of y is equal to e minus bar square kz square divided by 2m. Okay, so this is what you will get for this term. When this term is operated on psi, you will get this. So I am taking it to the right side. So this is the kind of a Hamiltonian the equation. Now we have to solve for this pi of y. Everything else, the wave function is already known. This kx, plane waves along x and y. So now we are going to we have to solve this. So now let us define. Let me define some y naught such that. That h bar kx is equal to eb y naught. If I define something like this, then in terms of this y naught, I can write down I can write down this one as minus h bar square by 2m into del square phi y by del y square. Plus 1 over 2m. Now I can pull this eb the whole square out, and I write the remaining thing as y minus y naught the whole square into pi of y is equal to the right hand side. I will simply call it as an e tilde into pi of y. So what is e tilde? So whatever I have here, this I am calling it as. It's a different energy. Okay. So now let us define the classical cyclotron frequency omega c as eb divided by m. So I multiply m here and divide by m. So that m square will be there in the denominator. So I get if I do this, then in terms of omega c, you can write down this equation as minus h bar square by 2m into rho square pi y by dou y square plus half m omega c the square into y minus y naught the whole square into pi of y equal to e tilde. Now this equation is something which must ring some bell, but this is exactly the Schrodinger equation for the harmonic oscillator. Okay, so this Hamiltonian is so this is this is an equation. So this is an equation for harmonic oscillator with frequency omega c, and centered at y equal to y naught. So typically what this means is that the harmonic oscillator potential, but if you want to understand how the potential looks like, so let's say this is your y and the potential is something that is its minimum is at y is equal to 1. That's all. Otherwise this is harmonic oscillator. Now the eigenvalues of this harmonic oscillator does not depend on where the minimum is. That only matters for the wave function. So the eigenvalues are basically the eigenvalues of harmonic oscillator. That means we have this e tilde, of course it depends on n, is simply h bar omega c into n plus half. This is a harmonic oscillator energy. So n is equal to 0, comma 1, etc. So this is our energy again. That implies, so this tells you that your energies E will depend on two quantum numbers. One is n and the other one is kz. And in terms of these two quantum numbers, this energy is h bar square kz square, like 2m, plus h bar omega c n plus 1. So this is essentially the energy eigenvalue of energy eigenvalues of this of this cyclotron problem, of this electron in uniform magnetic field. Now if you look at this energy, it is easy to understand that this is like this term is like kinetic energy. This is like kinetic energy of motion parallel to magnetic along z direction. So along, it's a free particle motion, so it is the kinetic energy of motion. Whereas this particular term is, this is the kinetic energy of orbital motion. Orbital motion perpendicular to B. That is in XY. Orbital motion is in a plane perpendicular. So these are the two contributions that you have. Now the wave function is, so corresponding to this, you have this wave function, which you can write it as phi n of y. So this is usual harmonic oscillator wave function. That is essentially you have what is called a Gaussian multiplied by Hermite polynomial. But of course, the only difference is that it is centered at y naught. So that is the only difference. Now you notice that So this is an important thing that you should notice here. That so notice that that this E, which depends on N and KZ, is independent of KX. That is another quantum number which is present in the wave function, but it is not present in the energies. So it is independent of energy. Okay. So that means, so this implies what? This implies for a fixed value, for a fixed N and KZ, the energy is fixed, right? So there are many degenerate states. There are many degenerate states. There are many degenerate states corresponding to different choices of different choices so we would be interested in finding out this degeneracy, because actually here you must recognize that N, this quantum number N, labels the Landau level. So it is important for us to understand that how many electrons can occupy a given Landau level. Given Landau energy. If you have to understand this, then so to answer this question, we require, we need to know the region. So how do we obtain this degeneracy? So the degeneracy is obtained by asking what are the possible values of K. So to find what degeneracy is, we have to ask this question: what are the possible values of K? So that is what that variation of this Kx is what determines how much the degeneracy is. Now, to find answer for this, let's try to look at two conditions. First condition is that let's apply periodic boundary condition. Apply periodic boundary condition. Along x. That means you have psi of x plus lx. That is the lx is the length of the system that we considered. Y comma z is same as psi of x comma y comma. This is what periodic boundary condition means mathematically. That means, so this implies that we have e to the power ikx into x plus lx should be e to the power ikx. So that tells you that your kx should be 2 pi by lx, 2 pi by lx into some integer. So it is some integer. So these are allowed values of your kx. Okay, so now you note that if you are thinking in terms of this integer, okay, you can have the structure is like a one-dimensional lattice, right? So you have a point here. So let's say this integer is 0, and then you have a point here, plus 1, minus 1, like that. So this goes on. So this is your 2 pi by L, and this is minus 2 pi by L. And this is 2 times 2 pi by L, that is 4 pi by L, and so on. Okay. So now you can ask a question that what is the step size or the cell size? Okay, you are asking what is the cell size. Okay, so cell size, I may simply call it as some delta kx, is simply 2 pi by lx, that is my cell size in this particular thing. Or in other words, sometimes we will say that what is the k space length per state. Okay, the cell size is also having this that kx space length per state. So that is also the language in which we can write this 2 pi by lx. Now let us look at another and we also have to understand that this kx also determines determines the value of y naught. Okay, so that is my second condition. So the second condition is that kx also determines y naught. Okay. About which the wave function is centered in the y direction. So that tells you that you cannot have this center somewhere outside your material, outside your system. So this tells you that your y naught has to be anywhere between 0 and Ly. Okay? Because your y naught cannot be more than the size of your okay? So that implies, what is your y naught? Recall, your y naught is equal to h cross kx divided by e times b. So that is your y naught, and you can write that in terms of so now supposing if you so that means you are going to ask the following question. That means you have 0 less than or equal to y naught and less than or equal to ly, that is 0 less than or equal to h cross kx divided by e times b is less than or equal to ly. So now we can ask a question that the maximum value of kx, let me call that as kx max. So the maximum value of kx is equal to ly eb divided by h cross. Okay, ly
EB divided by H cross. This is the maximum value. Okay, so now, so the second condition is setting the maximum value, and the first condition is setting kind of a cell size. So now we can ask a question. Combining these two conditions, we can get what are the allowed values of Kx. Okay, so the number of allowed values of Kx, so number of allowed values of Kx we can get by dividing this Kx max, we can get as follows. That is Kx max divided by delta. We have obtained what delta Kx is here. So that is equal to LYEB divided by H cross, and this divided by 2 pi divided by Lx. So this I can write it as Lx Ly. Lx will go to the numerator into B divided by H divided by E. I will write it in the following fashion, where I have used H is equal to 2 pi H cross. Okay, this is a Planck's constant and I have used that here. So, you can see that this expression, to find out the degeneracy of the energy, okay, I have to multiply this by 2, that is to take into account of the spin multiplicity. So the degeneracy of energy E is equal to h bar square kz square divided by 2m plus h bar omega c to n plus half is, so let's call that as some n, that is equal to 2 times this quantity, 2 times Lx Ly B divided by H by E. And this 2 is coming from the 2 spin states. And I will write this as Lx Ly divided by H by 2E. And generally, it is customary to write it in the following fashion. It is like some capital phi divided by capital phi naught. This is not the wave function. Okay. So it is written as capital phi divided by capital phi naught. Now, what is capital phi? Capital phi is, look at this one, your Lx Ly into B. Okay, so where is capital phi, that is equal to Lx Ly into B. What is this? This is actually the total magnetic flux. This is total magnetic flux penetrating the system. Okay, and fine art. Fine art is H over 2E. Okay, so in SI units, this has got the units of magnetic flux, and this is called flux quantum. Because remember, this is just has all these fundamental constants. So this is called flux quantum. Okay, and in that sense, your degeneracy is the number of flux quanta. Okay, so the degeneracy is simply equal to number of flux quanta.
So it is these Landau levels that we will use and do statistical mechanics to describe or to calculate what is called diamagnetic susceptibility. So that we will do in our next lecture.
Sir?
Yeah, hello?
Sir, is the flux quantum same as fluxure that we have studied in superconductivity?
Yeah, it is same. Okay, so is there any difference in the experience of listening to this lecture or directly? I hope there is no difference.
So there was only one noticeable difference. It was the pacing, sir. It was the pacing of the lecture.
So what is the difference? This is
This lecture was considerably faster than the regular lecture, sir.
Yo, this is faster?
Yes, sir. That's what I felt, sir.
Okay. Any other difference you find?
So, this might be funny, but someone who joined late asked me whether what is happening, is it his network issue? So your mouth is not moving, but you're speaking.
I forgot to switch off the video. So I think
that is also a difference.
Yeah, so these two are happening in two different times. Yeah, there is a concept called, I do not know if you people have heard, this is something called flipped classroom. Have you heard of this?
No, sir.
These days it is becoming a little famous because audio was very low. This was in the recorded thing or presently?
Sir, recorded.
Okay. Sir, I would like to remark one thing. Last time when your laptop was not working, so you chose to give the audio from the phone and the presentation from the laptop.
Yeah.
So that time the audio was much clearer than from the laptop.
Oh, okay. So even if it is working, I think I should do like that.
I wouldn't say so, but that time the audio was much better.
Okay, so maybe we can try that. Now, the audio in the present, whatever I am doing now, this is okay, right?
Yes, sir. Currently, it is fine. But if I may, usually I crank my volume up to the maximum. So now it is very clear. But last time when you were in from the phone, when you were giving the audio from the phone, then it was, I mean, my audio volume level was somewhat 50%.
Okay. Yeah, so I was just telling about this flipped classroom. The concept is something like this. There has been some complaint by students. I think a lot of research has been done mostly in Western world that it is very difficult to attend classes and concentrate on the screen for a long time. And also it is difficult for all the students to do this. And probably if there are many classes in a day, then it is strenuous to the eyes and continuously sitting in front of the screen. And especially if you are using a mobile, then it is much more inconvenient. So what this flipped classroom tells you is that, okay, the teacher will record the lecture and then send it to the students. And the students will watch this recorded lecture at their convenient time. Maybe they can watch it not in one go, but maybe in some steps. But then there will be a lecture where the lecture is short, but it is only there to clarify some doubts. So that is the concept of flipped classroom. Actually, there is no live lecture. You record the lectures and then send it. And then there will be a meeting. And the meeting is essentially to see if you don't understand something from that lecture. Okay, so that is what I thought I will try. So I have recorded this lecture. This is first time I am trying to do it, but I do not know. Somehow the recorded lecture, when I saved it, it has a memory of the order of 1.3 GB. And I think it is quite large. What is the kind of sizes that you have for the files that you are recording? This is just 33 or 34 minutes. 33 or 34 minutes lecture.
Sir, I think it has to do with the resolution of your laptop screen, sir. If you are recording the screen, if your laptop screen is full HD, then it will be recording a full HD video.
Okay.
Maybe if you reduce your screen resolution to 720p, then maybe the size of the recording will also reduce.
I just want to get some idea about... Okay, 30 minutes means it is 40 to 50 MB. Okay, that is very small. So, encoders are... So, what I am doing is, I found that in PowerPoint, you can actually record. So, I am using that. Okay, so in PowerPoint, you can video record. And then you can save that as a file, movie file. That's what I did today, but maybe there are better ways of doing it.
Different softwares take different sizes. Like in OBS Studio, the size is about maximum of 300 MB for 2 hours.
Okay. 300 MB for 2 hours. So I have somehow, there may be then the screen resolution also is one issue. I think I didn't check that. That I have to check. Okay. So that is, so any questions in this? In this lecture.
Did you understand?
Sir, psi x y z is equals to e to the power I k subscript x x times e to the power I k subscript z z times phi y from translation inference. Is it same as Bloch function? Bloch function.
Okay, let me just share that notes. Okay. So, what is a Bloch's function?
Like in a one-dimensional lattice. So along with the periodic harmonics function, we have a Bloch function multiplied to the.
So you have a periodic potential. Let's say V of x plus a is equal to V of x. Okay, so this is your periodic potential. Okay, now you have a Hamiltonian which is equal to p square by 2m plus v of x, where v of x has got this periodic property. Okay, and then we want to write down how do I solve h psi is equal to e psi. Okay, now you solve this equation. Then Bloch's theorem tells you that if this for periodic potential, you can write your psi of x to be e to the power I k x into some function, which depends on k, of course, u k of x, where this uk of x will satisfy, it will be a periodic function. Uk of x is equal to uk of x. This is called Bloch's theorem, right? So here you can see there is only one variable. Whenever there is a periodic function, you can write down the wave function as a periodic function multiplied by a plane wave. Okay. So this is different from what I have said here. What I have said here is more simple. What I am saying here is that if you have a Hamiltonian p square by 2m, okay, in one dimension, okay, then the psi of x is equal to some constant into e to the power I k x. Correct? This plane wave. If it is a free particle Hamiltonian, this is a plane wave. So, what I am trying to say here is that when you look at the Hamiltonian here, this is pz square by 2m. Correct? So this is essentially pz square by 2m and py square by 2m, and of course I have px minus eyb whole square by 2m. Okay. Now it is very easy to understand that it is free particle along z direction, and it is also free particle along x direction because there is no x sitting there. So since it is a free particle along z direction and free particle along x direction, it is going to be a plane wave along x and it is going to be a plane wave along z. Some non-trivial function will be there, phi of y, but you don't have any periodicity, or you don't have any periodicity. Here this is a free particle, so I cannot say phi of periodical thing. So this is different from Bloch's function. These are e power ikx ikz just because there is a translational invariance along x and z.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Sir, Hello? Yes, Abhijit. Sir, in that Hamiltonian, when you multiply, sir, that Px and Py component, when I take h square, wouldn't there be some cross terms there, or those are getting cancelled?
You mean in this last term?
Yes, sir. When you are taking that square, like h equal to 1 by 2m, h by I del minus e y b x hat whole square.
Correct. No, this is just a dot product, no?
No,
it will be equal dot product, no?
Yes, sir.
So you have h bar by I into dou by dou x minus E y b. This is your x component, right?
Yes, sir.
Plus h bar by I dou by dou y into y cap plus h bar by I dou by dou z, z cap. And this whole square is this dot this.
So I mistaken, I took the whole thing inside it as scalar, that's why.
No. This is a vector, so it is a dot product.
Okay, sir.
Sir, can you elaborate on flux quanta?
So I have read that there's a loop of flux around a semiconductor, superconductor, like a toroid. So that's a flux quantum. So.
Yeah. So basically, this flux quantum is like whenever we say that you define some quantity involving just the fundamental constants, okay, so then it is like you always write, because you will see this flux quantum coming in many areas, like in quantum Hall effect, fractional quantum Hall effect, all these two-dimensional electron systems. So there this flux quantum naturally appears as a unit of flux, magnetic flux through some material. So it turns out that there is some value. I think it is something like in CGS units. In CGS units, you define this phi naught as, you know, in CGS units you always write with C explicitly, so hc by 2e. Okay, if I put in these values, then your phi naught numerically will be something like 2.07 into 10 to the minus 7 Gauss centimeter square. This is the kind of value that you have for flux quantum. So which essentially means that you don't have fluxes smaller than this identity. You cannot find fluxes that are smaller than this. This is like the smallest flux. And any flux can be, it is like somewhat like the charge. Okay, so charge is always measured in terms of E, right? So something into E. So this E is, you can call this as charge quantum. So in that sense, this is like a flux quantum. And this is essentially Lx into Ly is the area, correct? So if you recall that figure, so I have Lx and Ly, so that is the area. So this is the total flux that is penetrating the system. So I have applied the magnetic field perpendicular to XY plane. So this Lx into Ly into B is the total flux that is penetrating into the system. And how many flux quanta are penetrating like that, if you ask, that gives you the degeneracy.
So in the superconductor physics, like 2E is the charge of the Cooper pair, right? But here 2E denotes what, sir?
There is no 2E here. I mean, 2E is not necessarily a Cooper pair, I think. There, I think it is accidentally, it turns out that 2E is, but generally this flux quantum comes not only in superconductors, in any two-dimensional electron system, where this 2E will appear. So basically, this comes in the flux quantum. In superconductors, it turns out that there are two electrons, that's all. You don't have to have a pair of electrons for flux quantum to be different. For example, here there is no pair.
Yes, so that's why I asked, like, why 2E is coming?
No, what I'm saying is that your flux quantum is defined with 2E.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Sir, flux quantum is defined with 2E because flux is, does it have to do with the dimension? Because flux is always the flow per unit area. Does it come from that? Mm-hmm.
No, 2E is just, it's not because of that. See, 2 is just a number. Whether 2 is there or not there, the units are not going to change.
Sir, I have an unrelated question about the interviews. Like, if I go for like theoretical photonics, what should I read before going to the interview?
See, in general, whatever field that you want to work in future, that will not determine your interview. Okay. Because most of the times, whatever research field that you will choose, people expect that you don't have any knowledge of that field. Because if you are finishing MSc, obviously you will have no knowledge of any research field. So it is not expected that if you want to do research in photonics, you should know photonics. But you should know, for example, let's say you want to do high energy physics and you don't know quantum mechanics, then that will be a handicap. So if you want to do photonics, then you should know optics, you should know lasers, you should know some electrodynamics. These are the related areas. Okay, so that is that way you have to find out what is the area that is basic to the research area that you are interested in. For example, if you are interested in cosmology, then you are expected to know special theory of relativity, general theory of relativity. If you are interested in high energy physics, then you should know special relativity, quantum mechanics, quantum field theory. So this is how you have, if you want to work in condensed matter physics, then you should know solid state physics, quantum mechanics, solid state physics, statistical mechanics. If you want to work in statistical mechanics, then you should know statistical mechanics, thermodynamics. So this is the expectation. So if you are, that is, if you are expected to do research in some area, then related basics at the MSc level, you are expected to be thorough. And okay. Most of the times, even if you are not thorough, it's not considered as a bad thing, because you can always learn whatever is required. But then you can always say that, okay, I want to work in high energy physics, but I did not learn quantum mechanics properly, but I'm ready to learn. But I know classical mechanics very well. You can ask me questions in classical mechanics. Sometimes interview board will consider such things also. Okay, if he doesn't know this, why should we check whether he knows, he can answer or not? So let us try to. So the policy, the purpose of an interview is always to see how best you know what you claim you know. If you say, I don't know something, they will not insist. Because everybody knows that you cannot learn everything. But if you claim you know, I know quantum mechanics, if you make that claim, then they would like to test how best you know. Okay, so that is the interview, the concept of interview.
And so what are the fields, the active research is going on in photonics, sir? In theoretical photonics?
Theoretical photonics, I think there are many things. I'm not very very much aware because of the literature in that. But people are looking at something called biophotonics, where people are trying to understand if some of the biological systems, when light interacts with these biological systems, and then how to get information about some changes in the properties of light that is reflected from the biological system will give some information about the biological system. Like, for example, people who are trying to understand the change in the plane of polarization from the glucose in the blood. And if you can use that to measure the sugar levels in the blood. So you can actually do it by not pricking. Every time you want to know how much sugar is there, you don't have to prick and take the blood out. But of course, one has to be careful, because you have to then get the reflected light from the blood. How do you get it? Because the moment you shine some laser, then it will be absorbed. So I think retina is the only thing in our body which will reflect the light. But then shining laser in the eye is not a good idea. So one has to develop protocols where you use a very low energy laser beam and then get it reflected from there, because we are not interested in the intensity, but we are only interested in the change in the plane of polarization. So you get the shift in the change in plane of polarization. You have to calibrate it, of course, to start with, and use that shift in the polarization to detect what is the sugar level in the blood. So this is one thing, it's called biophotonics. There is a group in ICER Kolkata. There is a person called Nirmalya Ghosh. He did a lot of work in this area.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, in quantum Hall effect, there we are considering this flux flux quantums?
There what happens in quantum Hall effect is that the conductance or the resistivity, whatever, that also will actually make some jumps. Okay, so when you increase your electric field, normally the conductivity will increase linearly, okay, or the current will increase linearly. But here what happens is this conductivity will make some quantized jumps. Okay, so that is what is called quantum Hall effect. That is where this topology and all these things will enter into picture. So there will be certain topological effects which will have a strong, so they make some jumps, and this conductance also will vary in some units of some universal conductance. Okay, so that is what people observe in quantum Hall effect.
Okay, sir.
Sir, in superconductors, when you talk about zero resistance, what does that mean, sir? Like zero means actually zero, or
yeah, in principle it should be zero. But when you are doing an experiment, whether you get actually zero or not is a different question. But in principle, it should be zero. I mean, in ideal situation, it should be zero.
Like numerical value will be zero.
Yes, I mean, it is expected that it is zero.
Yeah. Like at that time, can I use this like V equal to IR?
Yeah, so if you do that, what will happen? Even if you don't have any potential, okay, then even if you don't have any potential difference, the current will be going on. Okay, that is what is called persistent current, right? So the current will be there, and that is the excitement about superconductivity, right? So you don't require, you don't have losses, and you have very small potential difference can drive large currents.
So is it possible to use that current?
Use means what?
Like for practical purposes.
Yeah, you can transport and then use, you can use that current to generate large magnetic fields. Correct? So for example, high magnetic fields are generated.
So Josephson effect is considered as a product of this superconductivity. If we have no potential difference, we still have current.
Yeah, that is what is called persistent current.
And in squid, it is applied.
Yeah. So there in squids, you can see that some kind of a tunneling will take place of the Cooper pairs across the junction. And these squids are good sensors. In fact, they use, nowadays people are using these squids as qubits for some of these quantum computers, which IBM, this BlueJeans, these kind of companies are doing. They are using the superconducting quantum qubits.
So in the next semester, are you going to take the paper quantum entanglement?
Yes.
Okay.
That is offered every year.
Okay, sir.
Sir, Sir, if we overshoot the credits, can we still take another? I mean, if we are having enough courses to complete 72 credits, can we still take that course?
What, you have finished the 72 credits?
No, sir, I might be finishing in the next semester.
Yeah, see, we can always do more, there is no problem.
So, that doesn't put a restriction?
No. Extra is no problem. You should not do less. That's all.
So in your work, sir, do you use those supercomputers in IBM, like from your computer?
That is actually there in the there in my program, but I haven't used it so far. The first time, I think last to last year, during my course in quantum entanglement, I initiated using that IBM quantum computer as a practicing thing in the quantum entanglement course. So I asked each student to demonstrate or program that and show how to write a program and solve some problem in IBM quantum computer. So that was what happened last to last year. And last year I also asked them to try that, but last year I think we had this pandemic and then we did not continue till the end of the semester. But I think one student by name Valli Amai, she had done her MSc project on calculations using IBM computer. But except for this project work, I did not do anything much on that. But I want to do, there is a plan, but not yet materialized.
So I have seen that in my BSc and I tried to do something, but at that time I didn't know much and after that I didn't saw that, but last month and this month I was checking out those things again. So I asked.
Sir, is there overlap between statistical mechanics and photonics? Like you mentioned the biophotonics, I have heard about phototaxis and chemotaxis. There are statistical mechanics is used. Like for chemotaxis, I have seen chemotaxis being used, statistical mechanics being used.
Yeah. So phototaxis is not related to photonics. See, basically, chemotaxis and phototaxis are used as some kind of a driving forces for the movement of some cell or any particular part of the cell. Okay, so like for example, if there is some immune cell in your body, normally let's say these immune cells are going around in your bloodstream and suddenly let's say there is an attack by some pathogen at some part of the body, let's say there is a wound and then there is some bacteria, then there is a signal, and the signal is generally a chemical signal, in which case it is called a chemotaxis. Now, the signal will be by means of creating certain gradients in some biochemicals, and these immune cells, which are generally floating around in the bloodstream, will pick up that signal and then move towards the wound site and then try to ingest the bacteria and then clear off these pathogens. So this directed movement, okay, normally let's say the cell is just making some kind of a Brownian motion, but then you would like the cell to reach some location to participate in some wound healing activity or what is called disease controlling activity like that, then there should be some signal for that. So the signaling can be done by using a chemical gradient or by using some kind of a light Okay, so if you are using photons, then it is called phototaxis. If you are using chemical gradients, it's called chemotaxis. Now, to understand these things, one has to use statistical mechanics. These are not equilibrium systems, but still some of these ideas of statistical mechanics in terms of writing down master equation and then solving this master equation will be employed as tools.
So, like, is there any overlap between photonics and statistical mechanics?
See, statistical mechanics and photonics means it is like you can always talk about statistical mechanics is something which has overlap with everything. In some sense, anything that you want to do at non-zero temperature, you have to use statistical mechanics. So statistical mechanics has an overlap to everything. So there is nothing that you can do without statistical mechanics.
Okay, sir. Thank you. And so if one wants to pursue research in phototaxis or chemotaxis, so what kind of interview questions you might be asked?
Yeah, once again, I am telling you that you see, you are not a biology student, so you cannot be asked too many questions in biology. Okay, so you are expected to know something. So they might ask you some questions in statistical mechanics. They might ask you some questions in basic statistical methods, because in biology, most of the analysis is based on some kind of correlation, some kind of statistical methods.
So inferences, like chi-square test.
Yeah. So basic statistics and then statistical mechanics, equilibrium, non-equilibrium. So this kind of questions you can expect. But I think you should not too much worry about what you are going to do. I think if you are preparing for interview, the best is that you prepare for one or two subjects thoroughly. And if you have a specialization in your MSc, then you prepare well with respect to those subjects, basics of those specialization subject. Okay, so if you have a condensed matter specialization and you end up saying that, okay, I cannot answer questions in condensed matter, it doesn't look nice. Doesn't look nice means people may not hang you, but they expect that you are not serious. It's a specialization and you don't know anything about your specialization, doesn't look nice. So people think that, okay, you are specialized, but you are not, you don't know anything. It should not be like that. So if you have a specialization, then you should definitely do a good job of getting basics correct in specialization area. Similarly, if you have done a project in your master's, then you should definitely have good understanding of what you have done and what is the basics related to your project. Because project is like research, and you are going to apply for research, people would like to assess how seriously you have done research. So the project also, if you have done a project, then project also you should be thorough. Specialization, you should be thorough. In addition to these two things, you choose some two subjects and then try to go deep and then learn. It's not that you have to learn all the derivations. You have to just learn the conceptual. And once you learn that, then other things you can simply, some kind of a familiarity is enough. Okay, so you should. Essentially, interview is always kind of you have to be cool, and your presence of mind at the interview is what is more important than preparation. Because you can't expect a question, what they are going to ask. So you should generally get a confidence to yourself that, okay, I can handle whatever they ask. That kind of a confidence you should get, that's all. And there are always questions that come, like these are like some people may ask, okay, some mathematics questions, some plotting graphs, okay, give you a function, why don't you plot this graph? These are some kind of time pass questions sometimes people ask. And these things, sometimes they may treat them as questions to see whether, or sometimes they ask these questions to make the candidate at ease, because everybody, when they go for interview, they get tensed. And if they are going for the first time, seeing some 7-8 people sitting in the committee, they always have this anxiety and tension. So first, sometimes they would like to make the candidate relax and equilibrate to the environment. So they may ask some simple questions. Okay, first, of course, they ask, tell me about yourself. What is your specialization? Like that, some personal questions. But after that, they may ask you one or two questions where you will make simple questions. So after that, then they will start with your choice. Okay, tell me which subject you would like to be questioned, or what is your specialization, or what project did you do in your master's. So with that question, they will pick up. And then usually the first question that they will ask will be very simple. And the question's difficulty level will increase as you are answering. So they would like to take the level to a stage where you will not be able to answer. That is what tells them how you are thinking. So the aim of any interview is to learn how you think, not to see what you remember, not to see whether you know something or not, how you are able to think. So for example, if somebody is asking you, tell me the formula for entropy, so you say S equal to K log omega, and that question ends there, and there is no further this thing. And this something which you remember, or you probably understand, and then tell this thing there. But then there may be questions like they ask you something and you do not know the answer, but then they provide a clue, and then you pick up the clue and then arrive at the answer. These kind of questions will carry a lot of weightage, because in that process, they will understand your thinking ability. Because in research, what is that? You mostly don't know the answer for the question, and you should be looking for, you should have your antenna wide open to collect clues from various directions and then process that information and then solve the problem or get the answer for that. This is what research is all about. So they want to know how you are able to pick up clues and then analyze, come to the answer. And these kind of questions where you don't know but you arrive at the answer, they will have more weightage in the selection process.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Sir, I don't know whether I'm asking the right question here, but is it the condition for? I mean, currently there are researches happening on discovering this room temperature superconductor.
Hmm.
So. Has it already been statistically established? Has it already been modeled statistically? Theoretically, has.
See, there are certain theories. There are certain models which say that okay, if you do this, you will get room temperature superconductor. But that is theory, right? So nature need not follow what you are thinking is correct, right? So whenever somebody says this is theory, so there may be two difficulties. One difficulty is to exactly do what theory has done in the lab. Second thing is, even if you do it exactly, then the nature might spin a surprise. So far, there has not been any experimental breakthrough in terms of getting the room temperature superconductor.
No, sir. If we are formulating that in case of statistical with statistical mechanics, then what will be the considerations? Means, what will be different? Because you were saying last time that you formulated this statistical mechanics for the plasma metal junction.
Yeah.
So, how is it? How will it be different in case of room temperature superconductor? And in case of superconductors, we will be considering everything as bosons.
No, it's not. See, it's not very simple like that. I do not know if you people studied this DCS theory, DCS theory of superconductivity.
Yes, sir. So
we did graduation.
So probably in solid state physics course, maybe. So in DCS theory, it is a theory, it's one of the successful many body theories, but that is only for what you call as type 1 superconductors. All these high temperature superconductors like ternary compounds like cuprates and this lanthanum copper oxide, yttrium barium copper oxide, all these things, they do not come under that category where DCS theory is the theory for this. So, in some sense, I think there are many theories of high temperature superconductors. So, anytime when you have this quantum unibody problem, the electron correlations are very hard to deal theoretically. Okay, so you always have to deal them with some approximations. So, when somebody does theory, they are always trying to do it to some approximation. Okay, you say initially start with mean field theory. Then put in corrections progressively. Sometimes you may have to do computation. So these are always done in successive approximations. So it is not that you are doing an exact theory anytime, because that is why in our course on statistical mechanics we have been always studying what is called non-interacting systems. That is something which we can exactly solve. The moment you put in interactions, you cannot do it exactly. You have to only do it approximately, either by approximating the interactions or by approximating the so there is a limitation in theory also. It's not that we can do complete exact theory.
Okay, sir.
Sir, I attended the PhD thesis presentation of self-averting random walks. So in that field, what are the research going on? Like, it has some overlap with biology, like with proteins and stuff.
Yeah.
So what kind of research is going on over there? Like, I found it interesting. Like, it's a random walk, but it doesn't come back to its original position.
Yes.
So.
So essentially self-avoiding random walk is, we have used self-avoiding random walk as a model to understand the different conformations of a polymer. A polymer chain in a solution can exist in different conformations. And this the number of conformations is actually what is called configurational entropy. If the number of conformations are more, then the entropy is more. Like we discussed when we asked the question why rubber band shrinks when you heat it, because rubber is a polymer. Because when it is short, the number of conformations are large. So the entropy increases. So in the same way, we would like to understand how, in fact, we were trying to do a statistical mechanics exactly by finding what you call density of states. Density of states are essentially the number of conformations of a given length polymer in a solution. There, of course, two different models are there. We are using what is called lattice models because it is easy to do on a lattice. But there are also off-lattice models where people try to use certain potential where this random walk is done based on certain interactions. So that random walk is little more complicated. Nevertheless, many people have done it. So now you want to understand, let's say, we know that in proteins, you have a protein in some conformation, and suppose if that protein is supposed to do some particular job, or there is a function, and depending on what kind of function this protein is supposed to do, it will change its conformation. Okay, so this is generally called a phenotype. Okay, the phenotype of a protein will change. That means what it is supposed to do will determine what kind of conformation it will change to. And this is a very general problem, goes by the name called protein folding problem. So protein folding problem is essentially a kind of a change of the conformation from one form to the other. Like what we were, you were showing, that there is a coil kind of a form and there is a globule kind of a form. So coil to globule transformation, we were trying to understand it in the language of phase transition. Now this is quite useful in a field, something called drug delivery. Suppose you want to pack some drug in some protein, and then you would like to have that packed in a globule kind of a form, but then this protein will get transported into some location where this is supposed to be delivered. And there it is supposed to just unwind and then become a coil, so that the drug gets delivered there and it will do the job that is intended to do for. So drug delivery is one very active area of research in biology, where this kind of conformational changes are used as tools to bind and unbind to the drugs. And then once a drug is delivered, then the drug will go and bind to that particular molecule which it is supposed to ingest or cure or whatever.
Okay, sir, thank you.